ergonomics in cataract surgery, to me, is actually comfort while operating, both for the surgeon as well as the patient. Let's look at the steps that one can take to enhance the comfort during the surgical procedure. At the outset, it is important that the surgeon adjusts the microscope for optimal visualization during the cataract procedure. So the first thing that the surgeon needs to do is adjust the zero on the oculars on both the right and the left side, as demonstrated. Having achieved this alignment of the oculars, the second thing that the surgeon needs to do is adjust the IPD. So for which the microscope is turned on, the magnification is reduced, the surgeon focuses on a particular object and fine-tunes the interpupillary distance such that the surgeon now has a single, uniform, comfortable view of the operating field. And finally, the surgeon then needs to choose what is the magnification with which he or she is happy operating with, which for me is a 0.6. Now this completes the setup of the microscope. In an ideal scenario, I think it's best that the surgeon sets up all these things on the microscope even before he or she washes up for the cataract surgery. Now we look at the surgeon's comfort while sitting with respect to the foot pedals and the microscope and the sequence with which each of them needs to be adjusted. Conventionally, it so seems that most people have their phaco foot pedal on the right and the microscope foot pedal on the left. It's important that the surgeon orients themselves with the microscope foot pedal with respect to the on-off button, as well as with respect to where they need to press for getting the fine and the coarse focus. That apart, it's very important that the placement of the foot pedal with respect to the knee needs to be such that the angle of the knee should be more than 90 degrees. This allows for ease of dorsiflexion and plantarflexion of the foot. What I'd really like to say is that in case the foot pedal were a lot closer to you, giving you an angle that is less than 90 degrees, it makes this movement of dorsi and plantarflexion of the foot slightly more difficult. And therefore, I like to keep the foot pedals slightly further away to give me a little bit of an obtuse angle, which allows me to very easily negotiate the microscope foot pedal. A similar angle needs to be maintained even with the foot which is on the foot pedal to allow for the ease of maneuverability. Whether or not the surgeon chooses to actually wear slippers or not is a very individualistic decision. Me personally, I do not like to wear slippers because my mind is now tuned to the tactile stimuli from the undersurface of my foot as it rests on both the phaco and the microscope foot pedal. So what is the sequence we follow? First, we adjust the chair height to get you the optimal positioning of the foot on both the foot pedals. Step 2, get the microscope such at the correct height to make it a very comfortable viewing for the surgeon with minimum strain on the patient's neck. And finally, adjust the table height so as to get a perfect focus on the patient's eye. It's important that the patient also be equally comfortable during the surgical procedure. I like to put the chin up a little so that I get such a position that the iris is parallel to the floor. Sometimes a simple thing like just asking the patient to lift the knees may make the patient extremely comfortable by doing away with the lumbar lordosis, and this might be beneficial in a slightly longer surgery. Let's start with the checklist that every surgeon should ideally go through before starting the phaco emulsification procedure. Step 1, you should know what is the name of the patient, especially in a big list, because it's very important to establish that connect between yourself and the patient so that you can address the patient as and when required during the surgery. Point number 2, we've already examined the patient on the slit lamp, we've diagnosed the grade of the cataract, we have decided what is the nucleus disassembly technique that we are going to do for managing this cataract. So it's very important that you be very clear as to what are the settings on your console. That is, for the particular case in hand, you have set yourself the correct settings to deal with that grade of nucleus for the technique that you have decided to perform. Point number three, let's look at the handpiece. So take the handpiece and visualize the tip under the microscope. It's very important to ascertain that you've got the optimal tip that you want. It's a nice sharp tip. Now, so what do you mean by a sharp tip? This really is. So let's look at the tip under the microscope. The first thing you need to do is get the correct degree of exposure of the tip with respect to the sleeve. So this, according to me, would be a good degree of exposure between the proximal end of the bevel of the tip and the distal end of the sleeve. The holes on the sleeve should also be at right angles to the tip. The next thing you need to ascertain is that this is a good quality tip. You don't want something too blunt. So if this is what you would actually consider a nice sharp tip, for comparison, let me just show you what a blunt tip would look like. Now, this is a blunt tip, a tip that has been used several times, and it may not really be as effective in performing a successful phacoemulsification in a very hard cataract, because the amount of energy required to actually manage to emulsify the nucleus would be a lot more. Point number four, ensure that your irrigation and your aspiration tubings are firmly fixed on the phaco handpiece. Point number five, also ensure that you have a significant slack of the tubings so that you do not accidentally end up nicking any of them, resulting in an obstruction to the inflow or the outflow. Point number six, make sure that your second instrument that you want to use during the surgery, be it a Sinsky hook or be it a chopper, is the correct one for that particular case. Why? Because in a very hard cataract, you may not want a chopper like this. Instead, you may actually want a much longer chopper. So you can see here, we are comparing a short chopper with a longer one. The choice of the second instrument needs to be made at this point, because you have seen the patient preoperatively, you know what is the density of the nucleus, you know what is going to be the nucleus disassembly technique in this case, and therefore you know what is it going to be. Is it going to be a Sinsky or a fine tip chopper or a long sharp chopper? And finally, last but not the least, please check the IOL and confirm that this is the particular IOL which was chosen for this particular patient with respect to the IOL company, the IOL design, and the IOL power.